I wish I could share all the love that's in my heart. Remove all the...
Welcome to Conversations with Dr. Kim. Today we are going to cover curriculum instruction with Assistant Superintendent of Curriculum and Instruction, Dr. Jamal Doggett. We are going over the many ways that scholars across the district are being supported in their academics. Good afternoon, Dr. Jamal Doggett. Could you please tell us a little about yourself?
Sure. Good afternoon, and thanks for having me. My name is Jamal Doggett. I was born and raised in Mount Vernon, New York. I graduated from Mount Vernon High School in 1995, went to college, came back to be a teacher. I've been in the district for 23 years so far. I've done 6 years as a teacher at Edward Williams Elementary School, 6 years as an assistant principal, 10 years as a principal at Rebecca Turner, where we've done some marvelous things, and this is my first year as Assistant Superintendent of Curriculum Instruction. So again, I'm honored to be in this position to serve my community.
Well, congratulations, Dr. Doggett.
Thank you.
You've really come through the ranks.
Thank you.
Could you tell us a little about curriculum instruction? Give us the meat and potatoes of what's going on in the district.
Okay, we have a lot going on as far as new initiatives in all our departments in the curriculum instruction department. So I will start with ELA. We now have a phonics program, K-3, that we just launched this school year. We have our balanced literacy grades K-8, which we launched. We had to pivot a little bit midway, and we had to make some adjustments for that program, but overall it's been going pretty well so far. All our curriculum maps are on Rubicon Atlas now for grades K-12. As far as math, we have a new improvement plan because math is the priority. Those are where our lowest scores are for the district this school year. So we have an improvement plan which consists of a lesson coherent design, problem solving strategies, concrete pictorial extract, and small group instruction. So if the teachers K-12 implement those four phases, we're looking to see improvements in math. What we're also doing in math is that we are rethinking what we're doing as far as our math grade 8 course offerings for math. We're no longer going to have algebra 1 for all. We're going to go back to math 8 so students can get the foundation. And that will occur in the 23-24 school year. Same thing for science. We're doing the same thing with living environment. We're going to phase that out and bring back science 8. And for the students who can handle the advanced courses in living environment and algebra 1, we'll take those courses in 8th grade. We've expanded STEM programs throughout the districts, the arts as well. What other departments we have? We have our pre-K department has a new second step program which focuses a lot on SEL, our gifted and talented program. They've been revising their program to align with the New York State next generation standards, I should say. Our ENL program is underway. We have curriculum math for all Spanish courses. We've introduced a Microsoft Translator for entering and emerging students. We're piloting that in several schools. And our CTE program is pretty much our largest, fastest growing program in our department. This year we've had 3 approved pathways, and next year we're looking to have 3 more for a total of 7. So the curriculum instruction department has been pretty busy.
That's very robust. There's some exciting things happening in curriculum instruction. You also created a system where 8th grade students take exams. Could you take us through that a little bit?
Yes, that was new for this year. One of the things, what was new for this year, is that students who wanted to attend the STEAM Academy had to take an entrance exam. So this was new. So we informed parents in January and February at our high school choice night that there will be an exam. So the exam chosen was the pre-ACT grades 8-9. That information was given out. Parents were alerted. Students, I believe, taking that assessment on March 16th. Out of 271 students who took that exam, 211 were able to meet success, and they'll be entering STEAM for the 2023-2024 school year.
That's fantastic.
And I want to also say that number includes a lot of students with disabilities and English as a new language learners. So
I'm glad to hear that, because they should really be included in all our school buildings.
Yes.
Could you please explain what progress has been made thus far in any of the programs? You explained to us about ELA and math. Are we making any strides or progress? Could you describe that for us?
Yes. First, I do want to highlight some of the success that was made based on last year's test scores that just came in this school year, this fall. Many of our schools outperformed the New York State average in ELA and math on the New York State assessments. So we're looking to keep that trajectory next year. At this point, we've had data that has come in from the beginning of the year versus middle of the year, which shows promising results. There's two goals that the curriculum instruction department is trying to reach: to eliminate level ones and increase the proficiency levels. And the mid-year data that's come in is showing promise that that is occurring. So our students just took the ELA and math exam. We'll be taking Regis in June. So hopefully we'll have better results when they come out this summer. One of the things that we've also done to ensure progress is that we changed our APPR. Our APPR students' performance component is aligned to where we want to go. So, for example, we want to eliminate level ones. That's embedded in our new APPR plan because our district is measured on how many levels twos, threes, and fours for accountability status. So we aligned our APPR program in order to achieve those results. So everything's aligned. So moving forward, we should be achieving our goals.
For our audience, could you tell us what APPR stands for?
Yes, it's the Annual Professional Performance Review for Teachers. It's the teacher's evaluation plan where 50% of their evaluation comes from the classroom observations and 50% comes from the student performance, how they perform on these end-of-the-year exams. So we incorporated the iReady exam, we incorporated DIBELS, we incorporated the Regents exams as a way to measure our student success.
Thank you for that.
You're welcome.
How is curriculum designed to get test scores up and prepare students for the next stages of their lives?
Well, there's several ways that we're doing that. First, I would like to say that our K-8 model includes an RTI instructional period where the students are receiving small group instruction based on their needs. So you have the core model, the core instruction. You have tier two, which is targeted instruction, where those teachers are working with kids in small groups on their deficient skills. And you also have the intensive support where students are pulled out for the reading specialist as well. We also have reading specialists, which I just mentioned. We also have something that we call power standards. Now, this is very important because these are the critical skills that students need that show up on the New York State assessments. So teachers are teaching those students those specific skills. So it's important meat and potatoes of what they need to know. So that is also incorporated in there as well.
So we have some exciting news. Next year we plan on bringing in reading and math specialists. Could you speak a little about that?
Yes. So if you look at our data, we have, again, this goes back to alignment of reducing our level ones. Our data shows that we have a lot of students that are underperforming. And we want to make sure that we catch them up. So one of the things that we're doing is that our reading teachers are at capacity. However, we have students that still need services that are not receiving them. So a need assessment was done, a presentation was made to the Board of Education and yourself, and they're adding some additional reading specialists back into the budget. For the first time, and I would say maybe 15 years, we're adding back some math specialists. We're starting with four. We're going to see how that goes, and hopefully that will bring our math scores up because math is a priority. There are lower scores, and we want to make sure we jump on that right away and make sure that we do what we can to improve those scores and prevent students from failing from the beginning. So that's how we're going to utilize those math specialists.
Thank you for that. So a lot of parents have come to us and said that they're really interested in after-school programs and they want activities, they want programs to go till like 6 p.m. at night. Could you tell us anything about what's happening with after-school?
Yes, that's been happening since I was a student in elementary school. Mm-hmm. But one of the things we've heard the community, we understand the needs, and I've heard this as a principal as well, because what we have here in Mount Vernon, we have after-school programs. We have mm-hmm. something called Academic Power Hour. And that can only accommodate but so many students. So we're putting out proposals. We're seeking proposals from vendors to come in to see if they can provide, what programs they could provide, recreational activities, educational. It could be physical. It could be chess. Whatever they can bring into the district to help support our kids after school, it will also help parents with childcare as well, keeping students here to 6 o'clock and making sure that we're educating a whole child. Now, Academic Power Hour, it's for our students that we're targeting, but we also have some enrichment embedded in there. But again, the number is limited. So we want to make sure that those vendors that come in, whatever they bring in is aligned to what we want to achieve here in Mount Vernon. So we're working on that right now.
That's very good because parents do have to work and they need a place for their children, but we could take advantage of that opportunity and offer them enrichment services as well. So I'm looking forward to receiving those requests for proposals, and I hopefully we can, there'll be a little something for everyone within all of our schools, correct?
Yes.
Okay, what resources are available to students through curriculum instruction?
Students have a host of resources. Well, everyone has an electronic device. So that they have access to a lot of the software programs that we have. I will give an example of one. We have the Schoology platform where students can post work. Teachers can check students' work. If students are out or out home sick, they can go on Schoology and still get their assignments. Again, they have the iReady instructional lessons, the personalized lessons that's developed for them, learning.com. Just a host of programs. They have the regular curriculum that they have access to because, again, we have a lot of online programs, but there's, you know, nothing beats a textbook, you know, and paper as well. So we want to make sure we give them a well-rounded experience, but there's a lot of programs for them too. And they also have the classroom teacher. Mm-hmm. We can't forget about the classroom teacher as well, but we have a lot of online programs, a lot of online softwares that students from pre-K through 12 can use. Waterford, there's a lot.
Thank you.
And students, what we're doing also, I want to do talk about this, since we have a lot, we're looking to do a usage report to see which programs are being utilized the most, because sometimes we have a lot of programs and we just may have a lot of programs. Maybe we need to cut back and just use the ones that are giving us the biggest bang for our buck and to align to the direction that we want to go. So we're doing an assessment on that right now. We have a lot of programs, so we want to make sure that they're being used with fidelity and just pick out the ones that are aligned to where we're trying to go.
Mr. Doggett, how does data fit into all of these activities, resources, programs that we offer?
Oh, absolutely. Well, we have an RTI team. Data is the key to everything. So what we do, we look at our test scores. When we set individualized plans for students and which each school should be doing, and as a district, we look at our scores and we set a goal to where we want to go. And we measure that goal through formal and informal assessments. We progress monitor. We have an RTI team. We have an RTI leadership team, which supports the school RTI teams looking at data. How do you use this data to drive instruction? How do you use this data to tailor lessons to meet the needs of individual students? How do you monitor that throughout the year? Because what we're trying to do is look at the data to drive instruction, to improve instruction, but also make sure teachers are doing everything they possibly can to make sure students are not referred to special ed. So are you differentiating? Are you meeting the needs? Are you looking at that data periodically every 2 to 3 weeks? What are your common assessments saying? And, you know, that's pretty much how it feeds into. And so we look at each school, and each principal will give that information to us, and we give them strategies on how they can improve. And they tell us strategies what they're doing to improve as well, because they have a different lens than what we do. So it's very good that we have that collaboration between the schools.
Thank you for that. Yes, data is essential. It's very important.
I do want to say, but too much data is a problem too, because we have so many different data sets. What data set are we looking at? Are you looking at 3 different data sets and triangulating, or are you looking at 1 data set and just moving with 1 data set? And that's a building level decision, but sometimes we look at too many sets of data, so we have to kind of streamline the data that we're collecting and making sure that everything is aligned to where we're trying to go.
Well, one of the things that you typically say when people, they want results immediately, you always say?
It's a long-term plan. It's not going to happen overnight. What we're putting in place right now, these are the systems and structures of supports. So what we put in place can be sustained over time.
Over time.
Over time.
That's it.
So we have to understand that the things we're putting in place, we may not see the results right away, because research says you have to implement initiatives for 3 to 5 years in order to see change. So if change doesn't happen next year, it's okay, because the structure's laid out. We just have to implement things with fidelity and work smarter and just chip away at what we're trying to build. And we'll get there over time.
Over time.
Over time.
So it's really great that you fulfill these shoes, because we hadn't had a curriculum person for a while.
Yes, and that was the challenge coming in, because I did see that, you know, this position was vacant for quite some time. But it also was an opportunity, because I looked at it as, okay, no one was here. The focus primarily in the past couple of years has been COVID, so this is not to blame anyone. This is just where we were at the time. Mm-hmm. Now we want to bring curriculum instruction back to the forefront, and that's what we're doing. All our directors are in place. We're still missing the director of PE and health, but we're able to now move the instructional program forward. We have systems in place of support for teachers, principals. Mm-hmm. We have curriculum, and we're now just making sure everything moves forward as one unit. So that's been a building process. So that's been the process I've been doing all year, as far as well as doing a needs assessment to see what we need. So again, I'm moving forward, doing a needs assessment, and building the systems all at the same time. But it's an exciting time because I looked at this moment as an opportunity. So I didn't look at it from a deficit. I looked at it, okay, this is where we are. Where can we go? So these are the things I'm putting in to build over time.
Over time. So, Mr. Doggett, you also developed a very comprehensive professional development for staff this year. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. So I think it's the second question you asked me, what are all the positive things we have going on in our mm-hmm. in this curriculum instruction department? Everything that I mentioned has been PD for. We set up a superintendent's conference PD over 3.5 days. Where teachers receive development on professional development on foundations, balanced literacy, all the initiative that we just mentioned, the improvement plan for math, everything that was mentioned. Also, there's been ongoing PD at our curriculum meetings. I was appointed to this job June 7th, 2022, to start July 1st. June 8th, the first thing I reached out was, please make sure we standardize all the district's curriculum meetings, and that was important. So every curriculum meeting for each school is on the same day, because now that we have a CNI team, they can provide professional development. It's like, for example, our 7th through 12th grade English and math teachers now go to professional development during curriculum meetings with the directors and the department chairs, which wasn't done before because principals had their curriculum meetings on different dates. So now that every date is the same, it's now more cohesive. So mm-hmm. we have additional professional development then. Teachers also can sign up for workshops that they feel they want to go to in My Learning Plan. Mm-hmm. We've also done some walkthroughs this year and provided principals with feedback, and those principals gave that feedback to their staff as well. And principals have been using the APPR professional tool to provide feedback for teachers, and that's also a form of professional development. So there's a pretty robust professional development plan, but teachers can also seek PD on their own.
Very good. And how are you supporting educators additionally?
Same way. Through PD. We also, I do want to say with our educators, another thing I can add to what we said is that our CNI team, we have 5 directors, and they're excellent. We provide something called technical assistance and support. So if a principal or a teacher needs to reach out to one of them, they fill out a form of technical support, what it is, and the directors can go to the schools and provide one-to-one support. It can be whether instruction, it could be a PLC meeting, it could be a meeting with the principal on how to do a specific strategy, and that's been working so far. And it's documented as well, and it's also follow-up. So if the director meets with a group of teachers, there's a follow-up with the principal, so the principals are now in the know of what was discussed. So now the principal can go back and look for what was discussed in the classroom.
Very good. So could you tell us a little bit about whether your staff members go into the buildings? Are they doing walkthroughs?
Yes. We've done a series of district walkthroughs. I believe we've done 4 where the team has gone into schools and give principals constructive feedback. But our directors are also part of the APPR process. They're observing teachers. They're doing independent, unannounced observations. So they're averaging about anywhere between 30 to 65 observations of teachers.
Very good.
Yes.
Okay, lastly, Dr. Doggett, could you please tell the audience anything that you would like them to know?
Yes. First of all, thank you for supporting the CNI department here in the Mount Vernon City School District. I would like everyone to know that the plan that we put in place is a cohesive plan, but it is a long-term plan. Results will come over time. So please continue with the stick-to-itness, continue to support our students and support our scholars. And that's pretty much what I have to say.
Thank you so very much for that. I appreciate having you here today. I appreciate having you on our team. You're doing an excellent job.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And thank you for your support.
Thank you, Dr. Doggett, for joining me today. And thank you for being with Conversations with Dr. Kim. I appreciate it so much having staff members come to conversate with me and to provide information to the school district. We look forward to sharing more highlights from the Mount Vernon City School District next time.